Good morning. Do stand, let's worship together.
You make me strong as I roll. Father's Day. Grateful for everyone here. Go ahead and be seated. You can have a seat at this time. We're glad that you're here today, and fun to see people who don't always come. Sons bringing dads, and it's just a joy to see you out here today. Hope you have a great day as we, every day is sort of Father's Day. It's our Lord's Day and our Heavenly Father's Day, but today we celebrate too our earthly fathers, so we appreciate you being here for that. We have several announcements, and Renee gave me a long list, so pay attention, VBSers, all right? VBS starts tomorrow, Camp Kilimanjaro for our four-year-olds through sixth graders, and this should be a great week, but here's some announcements. 4 to 5 strong guys are needed to move a couple of heavy things after church. So that would be most of you guys. You're strong enough to do that. So helpers should be here by 8:45 in the morning to help get things organized and registered. If you have treats or drinks, please have them here first thing tomorrow morning or not before. I think they go in my office. I'm not sure about that. No, not kidding. Okay. Anyone wanting to help set up and decorate for VBS, please be here at 2 o'clock this afternoon. All right. How else would you want to spend your Father's Day? I mean, come on. Come be here at 2 o'clock for that. And we welcome prayers for all the children, teachers, and helpers. It's a great week. We want people to know that Madison cares about its children. They're a wonderful resource, and we're thrilled that we'll have 50, 60, 70 kids here learning about Proverbs, and that's what Camp Kilimanjaro is all about. It's about letting them know about the love of the Lord and teaching them. So pray for everyone involved that week. I didn't hear you. Yeah, it's air conditioned. Yes, it is. So, unless you're doing recreation. So. David and Marjorie, they have a whole bunch of fresh goods out there. It looks awesome. I mean, it looks like something from Better Homes and Gardens to me. Anything you want to say about that?
It's free. I'll be back there to help you, but we got sacks, got lettuce, trees, 4 different kinds of lettuce, romaine, and salad bowl, which is a loose leaf. Got big white radishes called Japanese daikon, et cetera, et cetera. Got sacks there. Please take it home. What we don't take, I'd be glad to take to food pantry in the morning.
All right. So help yourself, Dave. We're going to be back there afterwards to guide you through that, but some wonderful stuff. Dave will be back there. All in favor of a hard surface road down here, raise your hand. All right, we're good. Okay. You tell him we voted, and it's unanimous that we voted on that. So, actually, I ran into him, and I didn't get very far with him with it, but I mentioned it. Said, "Hey, we like that." So, anyway, so grab some fresh goods on your way out. Also, dads, men, today we thought we'd do something different, and so if you didn't get a root beer. We're not going to have a toast or anything like that. We're not going that high. You know, we raise our, but we have some root beer for our men today. We're just glad that you're here, and we want you to know that we think it's special that you came to visit us today. So I think that's most of the announcements. There might be some. We're going to, we got one in the back.
There's what?
Okay, the Division One Benevolent Project. We showed a video on that. I think that was the Lifted Up that our son, actually Darren, was part of. He just returned. He might be here next week to share a little bit about that. But they give loans to poor farmers. He just visited a pineapple farmer, and $100 goes a long way to a pineapple farmer. And they've had 100% paybacks on all their loans so far. And there's some women. I'm hoping he's here next week and might get a chance to explain that program a little bit and how it works. It's kind of a new wave of missions, and it seems to really be making a difference where instead of just giving them a free handout, they're having to work, and it sounds neat. So anyway, that money is due to the CCW Benevolent Project if you want to give to Lift It Up International. Thanks, Dottie. We're just going to have a video that will lead us into our prayer time again. It's just kind of to honor our earthly dads, and so if you would, direct your eyes to the screen, and we can be thankful for those dads.
You got this.
A hug might be good.
You got this.
got this! You got this.
Dear Jesus.
You got this.
I want to invite you into my heart.
Ms. Douglas, they're ready for you.
He needs
a- you got this.
Not a nice way to end that, was that? As we come to prayer time this morning, there's many mentioned in your bulletin there. Had a little bit of an update on Delmer Ford. His kidneys still are not filtering. They're still removing fluid, but not filtering the blood. Larry left a message for me that said he was up and going this morning. They're weaning him off of his oxygen. Things are going pretty well, but he's on dialysis, and so that just might be the way it is. He didn't know what that meant moving forward, but as far as today goes, things were going about as well as they could be. Does anybody else have any prayer requests or updates on anything? Charlie.
Anna went into labor yesterday. Holly's in Omaha, so pray for that.
Okay, I missed that. No baby yet?
No baby yet.
Okay. Hannah's in labor, and Holly went to Omaha to help. thank you for that. Anybody else? Mary? In Des Moines? Okay, Dorothea Lang is in hospice care in Des Moines. Anybody else?
No storms and no fluctuations. I can't handle the pain anymore.
The rain does affect you?
It does me.
Okay.
How long have you been doing this week?
Okay. Well, I think we could all use some sunshine.
Amen.
Mary Ellen? Anything? Okay, I don't know what is on Facebook. Okay, I did not know anything about that. Malcolm Mayo has an infection in his blood, and I assume they're doing their best to treat that. I'm probably not. Oh, okay. He's in Marshalltown Hospital. Evidently, we're not all friends with the same people, because I hadn't seen that. So I keep Malcolm in prayers and his family also. If not, happy Father's Day to everybody, and we'll go ahead and go to our Heavenly Father in prayer. Almighty God, Father in heaven, we thank you so much for this day to come to worship you in your house, and we thank you for all the blessings that we have received, and we know that you give us so much that we take for granted, and we ask that you forgive us for that, and may we understand truly all the gifts that we've been given. We have a list of many people who are in need of your love and your strength and your healing, many that are dealing with serious health issues that only you probably can to answer the questions and about the why and how. And we thank you so much for knowing that they're in your hands, and that if they are your children, they'll eventually we'll all see them again, and that your grace and mercy will cover all of us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thank you. excitement is at hand. We're going on safari to a far away distant land.
Let's get the job
going. Sing the songs of Africa and join its life force. Gain wisdom from the words of life that God has laid before us. Jungle, let's go.
Again, all the fun begins tomorrow morning, bright and early, and keep us in your prayers. We appreciate all those who have helped in some way, whether you provide the snacks or whatever it is. There's lots going on, but we appreciate all our volunteers doing a great job with Camp Kilimanjaro. Fun to have a special speaker today, for me anyway. He's a great preacher, but I must, if I'm honest, and I am pretty honest, I have slept through more of this man's sermons than any other preacher I've ever listened to. I'm just telling you, all right? So, and usually my mom would look at me, you know, the church we grew up in, the choir loft was over here, and if I fell asleep during the sermons, like in junior high, mom was in the choir, and there was always this eye thing going on, and I always knew I was having big trouble if we'd been messing around, you know, it was like I had to deal with mom. But she usually passed me off to Dad. So, Dad's a great preacher. I have a brother that's a preacher, and I'm a preacher. And well, not for real long. I was a youth pastor. Some don't see that as a preacher. But anyway, when we get together, we often talk about who's the best preacher. And it's kind of surprising. We all agree Mom wins the award. Mom's the best preacher. So, no, Dad's a great preacher. I don't know how many years he's been preaching, but a long, long time. And does a great job. He still preaches at a church in southeast Nebraska, Brownville Church of Christ, Brownville Christian Church. And quite an amazing story. Does a great job. Mom's a great help. They're a great team together. Let's see. What more can I say? It's Well, I hope he goes long. I hope he goes real long today, so then you appreciate me a little more. So, anyway, he's a great preacher. He comes highly qualified. He graduated from Nebraska Christian College with a degree in ministry, pastoral ministries. I don't know how smart he is. I mean, I'm being respectful here. Here's why I say that. He had three kids in college, and so he decided he wanted to go back to college while his three kids were in college. So, it makes me question how smart he is, but he is very wise. He went on to get his master's from Creighton University in ministry. He went on to get his doctorate and from San Francisco Theological Seminary. So he's got this name, Bob Chitwood, with all these little things at the end of it. I just call him Dad.
Thank you, Brian. Son. Well, it's a delight to be here. I bring you greetings from the Christians in Brownville, Nebraska. It's a small rural town. We celebrate our 160th year as a congregation next Sunday. It's the oldest Christian church in the state of Nebraska, and that includes all organized churches of any denomination or background. So the Christian Church, Church of Christ, Restoration Movement, however you wish to call it, has deep roots in that southeast corner of the state. And Pat and I are pleased to be in this small town. It's only 135 people, but to think that our Christian roots in that part of the world began before Nebraska was a state is sort of an inspiration to us, and we love the history there. This church here at Madison has always been an inspiration to me as well. I think I try to reflect on who preached here and who I knew. Wasn't there a fellow named Bob Seath? Okay, I think that was my first acquaintanceship with this congregation. Jack Raymond. I just don't remember them all. Of course, Dennis Smith was one of our Timothys from Griswold when we served there. So we had reason to be thoughtful of this congregation. And you've been a beacon of light, and I commend you for it. And it's, I know we're really comfortable here today, not because of Brian and Barb, but we're always comfortable around them. But I'll bet you sat in that same seat in this same church for years, haven't you? As a pastor, I've never have figured that out. We had a new family been worshiping with us. They were there 3 weeks, and they came up, the lady came up a week ago, and I always sit over on that side before I get up to lead in the service, and she leaned down and she said, "Could you do something about it?" And I said, "What?" She said, "I've been here 3 weeks and somebody is sitting in my seat." And when I looked out the window this morning, there you were. You started flowing in here, and you not only had the same seat, you had the same parking stall. It was like you were out shooting pheasants. There was a car here and a car there and a car there. And I thought, yeah, this is where we belong. This lady was having some difficulty. She was at home, and she'd been under the leadership of John Epperson, who happens to be a preacher that I know. And sure enough, somebody broke into her house, and she just was frightened by this, and he was there to steal. And she saw him. She came around the corner, and there was, and she just cried out, Acts 2:38. Well, if you know John, he taught that forever. You know, everybody in his church knew that text. Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Christ, so forth. And she hollered it out, Acts 2:38, and it so stunned him, he left. Well, he got picked up by the police. Had to go before the judge. The judge said, "Why, when you were robbing this woman, did you leave when she cried out a scripture verse?" And she responded, "Well, he had an axe and 2:38. So I know I'm in a comfort zone here today. It's wonderful to be here on Father's Day. It means a great deal to me. We're very thankful to God for Brian's leadership. And he gifted us with Barb and two wonderful grandsons. And they're wonderful. It's probably the best gift Brian gave us. Isn't that what you wanted me to say, Barb? But we do love them, and we're thankful to God for them, and thankful for your love of them and support and encouragement. It means a great deal to any of us who are in the line of work that we chose to have people who love us and pray for us and encourage us in our Christian walk. And we need that desperately. So thanks for being a prayer partner on their behalf and also an encouraging voice. Father's Day, how wonderful it is. Do you live your life in the light that you have a Father who is in heaven? I hope so, because it'll make all the difference in how you live your life. I've lived long enough and preached long enough to know that there are men and women and young people who have a little bit of a question about, is there a heaven? or is there a hell? We sometimes don't even like to talk about that. But it sure can change your life when you make your choices and you believe that I have a Heavenly Father and He lives in heaven and He's interested in my daily life. You see, God our Father sees things differently than we do. There was a time in my life when I boarded a train in La Crosse, Wisconsin, and we'd go down to Savannah, Illinois, switch trains and go from Savannah to Omaha, Nebraska, and then board a bus and go to Norfolk, Nebraska, where I had chosen to go to college. To me, that was adventure. It was exciting. I get on these different trains and made my way to this small town in Nebraska and looked forward to it, meeting people and just sharing life. And the whole thing was exciting to me as a 18, 19-year-old back in the 50s, 1954. My father didn't see it that way. It's amazing. He wasn't sure that his son, he wanted his son to be a preacher. That wasn't a fear, but he had a different viewpoint. He knew that his father, or his son was boarding a train and he'd get into Savannah, Illinois late in the night and he'd drive all night on another train and get into Omaha at 7 a.m. and then have to make these transfers. And to him, he was concerned about his boy. You see, a son sees it differently sometimes, or a daughter. And God our Father looks down upon you and me, and how we see it is not always how He sees it. Brian made a choice one day to give up some of his carpentry work. He was very good at it. He was an unusual son. He's the only boy I ever knew who went to bed with a board and would sand it all night long. And we had more dust in that bedroom than any other room in the house. But he loved it. And for him, there was nothing quite like this. A board had a different feel to him. He enjoyed working with his hands. And he did some specialized training in Lincoln, but he then chose to be a minister. And it was strange. Suddenly, this young man, Bob Chitwood, had different vision as Brian Chitwood was now his son and was going to leave home and make some choices. It's different how a child sees it. He saw it with a chance to get back to school with his brother and to share together, and some in sports and to meet friends and probably find a girl. He had to wait to get one out of Kansas, though. But and that's the only thing I really ever had trouble with about Barb, but but we just see it differently suddenly as the father and the son. And you've had that experience. But I'm encouraging you today, as best I know how, to see that you have a Father in heaven who looks down upon you today with a tremendous amount of love. We have four children. Now, I love our family, but I love each of those kids individually, and so does my wife, Pat, in different ways. Right now, our daughter, Diane, is facing cancer. She gets a lot of our attention. She gets a lot of our prayers. She gets a lot of our encouragement. She gets more of our smiles and our laughter and maybe an act of kindness and chicken salad and other items that we know are special. And we go out of our way like we're going to do to go from here back to see her because her son is coming and we want to be there to share. You see, as a father, you begin to invest yourself and your love and your grace and your mercy in a way different than when you were a child. Because that's a father's love. And when I think of how he loves me and loves each of you, it's with an immensity and an enormous amount of care and mercy and grace. And when we're in trouble, when we break his word, when we break his heart, he has a heart. He's a person. Our God is real. And this personality is broken when you and I break his way and his will and seem to drift or wander. But he loves us so downright much that he reminds us again, I gave you my boy. I gave you the best I had because I want to be with you forever and ever. I want to have an eternity with you, Bob. I just don't want to take care of your misgivings in this life. I'm preparing you for a tomorrow where you will be with me forever and ever. I'm so grateful that I had a godly father and mother. I was very fortunate. And I'm grateful for their love. But the best gift they ever gave me was Jesus. My parents were faithful in worship and attendance. I can remember sitting by Dad. I'll never forget it. 12 years old, he knew I was under conviction. George Mingy had been preaching a revival in Viroqua, Wisconsin, and we were there for every service. And he knew I was thinking about making a commitment to Christ, and he was in prayer for me. Thursday night, he said to me, Bob, I thought you were going to go make a decision tonight. And I said, Dad, I thought maybe I would. He said, well, I just want you to know, son, I'm praying for you. And you have my support. So it was easy to make the decision on Friday night of the meeting. And I did. You see, a father's love, one of the best gifts you dads can ever give your son or daughter, your mate or whoever, is the love of Jesus. Eternal life. I've stood too many times by the graveside. John can attest to this. Brian can attest to this. What a wonderful blessing it is to be able to stand there and know that this person whom we have said goodbye to will live forever because of his or her faith in Jesus Christ. It makes it so much easier as a pastor. I've also stood there when families can't get along with each other because they haven't had that balance of living in a world where Christ is in heaven and the Father is waiting to receive us home. Since God is a father, he's interested in you. I've always been thrilled by the gospel story there's a Sermon on the Mount and 5,000 and several thousand listen to Jesus at different times. But isn't it something? He could find Nicodemus and visit with him in the darkness of night by himself. He could find a widow of Nain who lost a child. He could find a man diseased 38 years and bring him healing mercies. he could find a woman stained by the sin that she had committed in her life and offer her grace and forgiveness. He could tell us stories about two boys who each got an inheritance, each had special needs, and how they came home and discovered the Lord, their Father. You see, our Father is not only interested in our whole congregation here today, he's interested in you and whatever you're experiencing. He knows the cancer that's in your life. He knows the sin that's in your life. He knows the pain that's in your life. He is a father who cares about his son or his daughter. Jesus taught that faith to us. He said, if you then, you fathers, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more shall your Father which is in heaven give good things to them that ask him? I taught our son well, Brian, when I was young. I loved auctions. You like auctions? I love auctions. Not as much as I used to, but I did. And I went to this auction up right by Main Street on our hometown. And I'm sitting there, and I got all excited. There was this lovely chair, and I thought Mom and Dad would love to have this lovely chair. It was bright blue or purple. Had tassels. This is classy. And I spent my own money on a Saturday morning and bought that chair for Mom and Dad. I knew they would love it. Now, we had a little brick home that was like a cottage. There was not enough room for a chair of that kind in that house at all. But isn't it amazing what a father does? He gave up fishing on the Mississippi River to come because I'd hid the chair, I thought I had, in the bushes. I've driven Pat by that house many times and I'd say, that's where I hid the chair. And Dad was not happy. He was not happy. He didn't want that chair. He wanted to be fishing with my Uncle Lorne on the Mississippi River. He worked 5.5 days. He didn't want to spend his Saturday afternoon fiddling around with me in a chair. But you know what? That chair was with my mom and my dad the rest of their lives. I can tell you one thing, I'm glad I didn't inherit it. So I passed that kind of thinking on to Brian. Brian one day decided he wanted to do something nice for his mother. So he went to a garage sale. I think it was Mother's Day or her birthday, something like that. And guess what he brought her home? A 5-iron golf club. Pat has never swung a golf club in her life. But Brian, I think, needed a 5-iron, and so it was the way it would work out. You see, we as fathers, we know how to give good gifts. And our Father in heaven knows how to give you a good gift as well. It's called life eternal. It's called forgiveness of sin. It's called be my child, son. Be my child, daughter. And he said, your Christianity, Bob, just needs to be lived out. You don't have to go through a whole lot of formality. You don't have to ring a bell. You don't have to wave your arms. You don't have to do any of that. You don't have to wear robes. You don't have to do things that would sort of separate you from other people in your society. Just live your life and be my son and be my daughter. That's all I ask. And I'm going to close. I just love the picture Scripture gives us of God. I love that picture that he stands there as the Father, waiting to receive us. We can come back to him sometimes ragged, shamed, muddied, but his arms always welcome us. such as our Heavenly Father. It's so nice to know on this Father's Day that I have a Father in heaven who cares about my sin, who cares about my destiny, and said, I will give you the best that I have to give, my beloved Son in whom I'm pleased. Listen to him, obey him, love him. If you do, you'll be with me forever. Thanks be to God. Let's sing our closing hymn, turn it over to Brian, he'll lead us. Thank you for the opportunity and the honor today to share faith with you.
I didn't sleep in that one today. Lots of wisdom, appreciate what he has to say. If you've never discovered the love of that Heavenly Father, it can be yours. And Mom, if you're done with that five iron, I'd like that back. That'd be great. Just a reminder, Vacation Bible School, there are some, we need four or five heavy-handed, not heavy people, but heavy-handed people here to help us move some things right after church. And at 2 o'clock, I know they're setting up. If you have time to do that, if you're not, we understand that as well, but if you're free to help with that. Anyway, if you would, let's stand, and we'll sing our closing song. Let's pray, and then we'll sing. Heavenly Father, it is a privilege to be called your child. Thank you for the benefits that we have from being united with you, being able to have a dad who cares about our lives. Pray for anyone here that's never discovered that joy, that they may discover it, an unconditional love. When they come face to face with who they are, they realize their life hasn't measured up, their sin that needs to be accounted for, and that you provide the grace that wipes all those sins away. So we're thankful for that. You provide a life and a life everlasting. We look forward to the day we'll be with you. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.